I am Professor Kambale, working in the Department of Commerce, Rani Chennamma University, Belagavi. In all, I have put in 34 years of service in the university. Prior to working in the Rani Chennamma University, I have worked as Professor of Commerce and Head of the Department of Commerce in Mangalore University and Karnataka University, Dharwad, respectively. 12 students have obtained PhD under my supervision, and 6 students are pursuing their research. In addition to teaching, I have worked in the administrative capacities of all the 3 universities where I have served so far. I have also worked as member of the syndicate, academic council, and finance officer of Karnataka University Dharwad and Rani Chennamma University Belagavi. I am happy to learn that the Department of Commerce of Rani Chennamma University is organizing online research methodology course in this academic year. And I am also told that many students have registered for this course. Research methodology capacity building program will help the budding researchers to master the art of research methodology, which will not only help them in their research, but also will enlighten them about the different aspects of research that one needs to follow to successfully complete the research project. The organizers of this 1-week online research methodology course have asked me to share my views on ethics in research, which I will try to share with you in this lecture. Ethics is a very important subject in these days of digital era. Lot of literature on the topic chosen for research is available on the internet. Research thesis done on various subjects are also available on the internet. This has made copying and cut and copy paste very convenient. This is nothing but indulging in unethical practice, and this will not enhance the knowledge of the research scholar as well as contribute to the development of policy decisions. As the research produced by indulging in copying and pasting will not generate any new knowledge. So ethics has assumed lot of importance in these days of knowledge, in these days of flooding of information on the digital platforms. It is my experience in these years of 34 years that most of the theses that we get for evaluation are not original, and they are not up to the mark, and they are full of plagiarism. So to avoid all this, one needs to be ethical research. We need to follow ethical practices in carrying out research so that not only the research scholar become knowledgeable about his research project, but he will also be able to contribute inputs to the policy makers by making suggestions in his report. So in view of this ethics, knowing more about ethics in research becomes very important. Before we go into the details of ethics in research, it is very appropriate to understand the meaning of research in as brief a manner as possible, as many of you may be knowing this. The term ethics has been derived from the Greek word ethos, which means one's character or disposition. Character here means a person of strong moral beliefs. When a person is honest, sincere, hardworking, and does not follow deceptive things in his day-to-day life, we say that he is a man of character. So in other words, a person who follows ethical norms is said to be of high moral character. It is in this sense that the term ethics is used here. So ethics refers to a system of moral principles, and moral principles help us to know what is right and what is wrong, and also their motives and consequences. Ethics also refers to the conduct that distinguish between acceptable and unacceptable behavior. So ethics is a science of wrong and right things. It's a science where we can distinguish the behavior of a person into acceptable and unacceptable. So whosoever does good things is said to follow ethics. Whosoever does right things is said to follow ethical principles. Whosoever does wrong things, or whoever does bad things is said to follow unethical principles. So in research, one is said to follow ethical means or ethical practices, provided he does certain things which are forbidden. We will come to know the unethical practices in research at the end of my talk. Suffice is to understand that ethics is a subject of right or wrong things. And in ethics, what is emphasized is that people should follow right things in their research. Right things are those things which are acceptable by the people at large. Wrong things are those which are not acceptable by the people in the academic world. So if you follow the things which are acceptable by the academicians, we say that you are following ethical norms and not otherwise. So this is in brief the meaning of the term ethics. Now comes the sources of ethics. There are mainly three sources of ethics or ethical principles. They are religion, cultural experience, and legal system. Now, religion is one of the oldest sources of ethics. All the religions, be it be Hinduism, Islam, Buddhism, Sikhism, all these religions preach about the necessity of ethical practices. They provide fundamental principles of ethics. So religion that we belong to gives us the list of do's and wrongs. And whosoever does the things as prescribed by the religion that one belongs to is said to be an ethical person. So religion is a source of ethical principles, and it is one of the oldest sources of ethical practices. Second is cultural experience. Now, culture refers to set of values, rules, and standards that are transmitted from one generation to another. And if one follows them, will produce behaviors that fall within acceptable norms. So cultural experience is also a source of ethics. So what happens here is that if a person learns certain things from his parents or from his grandparents as to how one should behave in the society, or so if he behaves in the manner that are told to him by his relatives, by his elder people, by the elder people in the family, then that produces behaviors which are acceptable to the people at large. So cultural experience can also be called as the source of ethics. And the third and the last important source of ethics is the legal system. Now, laws are rules of conduct approved by the legislations that guide the human behavior, and they codify the ethical expectations and modify as new evils emerge. So law is a very potent source of ethics. Now, we know that if we do not follow the law, we'll be punished by the judiciary or by the legal system, and we avoid behaving in that way. So legal system of the country also acts as a source of ethics, as it prevents people from behaving in a manner that violates the laws passed from time to time in a particular country. For example, wearing helmet while driving the two-wheeler is compulsory. So otherwise, police people, traffic people will levy the fine on us. So this law, which has made it wearing helmets mandatory, will be violated if we do not wear that. So what we do is we wear the helmet while driving the two wheelers. So this is how laws of the country prevent the people from behaving in a manner which is against the laws of the country. So legal system that prevails in a country, it can be called as a can be taken as a source of ethics. So these are the three sources of ethical principles that we come across in our day-to-day life. And following these, whosoever follows the dictates of religion, cultural experience, and legal system can be said to follow ethical practices in his private as well as in his public life. Next comes next important thing is about the history of ethics in research. Now, if we survey the literature on ethics in research, we will come to know that till 1960, ethical issues were not raised in research areas. Even though there were unethical practices in research, like widespread use of deception, invasion of participants' privacy, lack of confidentiality in research, etc. In 1960, people became aware of unethical practices in medical research. So some institutions who were funding the research projects became aware of the unethical practices, and National Research Act was passed to prevent unethical practices in research, more in human research. So ethics in research came to the forefront since 1960, and because of the national research that was passed. There are two perspectives to establish whether research is ethical or unethical. They are utilitarian perspective and deontological perspective. The first perspective is that if actions related to research involve or likely to involve more benefits than harm, the consequences which are positive and which provide the greatest good for the greatest number of individuals are considered as effect of ethical practices in research. This is called utilitarian perspective. In this ethical dilemma, cost-benefit analysis are made. So in utilitarian perspective, benefit that accrues to all the stakeholders is emphasized more. If the benefits are more than the cost involved in that research, then that is accepted by the utilitarian perspective. So cost-benefit analysis is done, and if the benefits accruing to the people are more than the cost involved, then we say that it is utilitarian perspective. The second perspective to know whether the research is ethical or unethical is deontological perspective. In this, according to this perspective, research should follow universal rules of morality, and ethics. Here, the consequences of actions are not considered. Moral principles such as do not tell a lie and always keep your promises must be followed all the time. It is strict adherence to moral behaviors and universal rules of ethics. According to this perspective, research involving deception is unethical, even if it benefits more than costs. So according to deontological perspective, the researcher is expected to follow universal moral principles. The consequences of action are not considered here, whether they are going to benefit the people or not, that is not important. Even if they benefit more people, then also that research is not considered as ethical. What is important here is that we must follow universal rules of morality. Moral principles such as do not tell a lie and always keep your promises must be followed all the time. Whether the research will benefit the people or not is of secondary importance so far as this perspective is concerned. And cost-benefit analysis is not undertaken here. What is more emphasized in this perspective is that the researcher should follow universally accepted moral principles, no matter whether the research brings benefit to the society or not. So these are the two perspectives which will help us to establish whether research is ethical or unethical. In utilitarian perspective, benefit is more emphasized more. If the research is going to benefit larger number of people, then it is taken as ethical. So there is some scope for using unethical practices here, because the benefit of larger people is kept in mind and not the benefit of the entire community. In deontological perspective, benefit is not at all given any importance. Cost is also not given any importance. What is given importance to is following of moral rules, moral principles that are accepted world over. So moral principles like do not tell a lie and keep your promises always ought to be followed every time without bothering about whether the research is beneficial to some people or to more number of people. and whether the cost involved is less or not. So those commercial considerations are not kept in mind in deontological perspective. What is kept more in mind is the following of moral principles that are followed not only in the native country of the respondent, of the researcher, but throughout the world. So these are the two perspectives that help us to distinguish between research which is ethical and research which is unethical. Then comes importance of research, importance of ethics in research. Now the following points highlight the importance of ethics in research. First is following ethical norms in research promotes the aim of research. Ethics, if one follows ethics in research, it will help him to promote knowledge, truth, and welfare. At the same time, it will help the researcher to avoid errors, falsification of data, and misinterpretation of the data while carrying on research. So research will achieve the purpose for which it is undertaken, provided ethical principles are followed. So research is undertaken not for only degree sake. Research is undertaken to generate new knowledge, to establish the truth, and to ensure the welfare of the humankind. This is possible when you follow ethical principles, not otherwise. If you follow ethical principles in research, you will be able to avoid errors. You will not feel like falsification of the data, and you will also not feel you will not be tempted to misrepresent the data in research. So following ethical norms in research will promote the aims of research, that is to generate knowledge, new knowledge, to establish the truth, and to ensure the welfare of the people at large. Second is, it develops guidelines. Now, ethical values you followed in research will help to develop the guidelines. Mostly in today's world, research is collaborative work. So when the research is of collaborative work, what is required is sharing of information with other fellow researchers, colleagues, or institutions funding the research and the society at large. So what is important here is that trust, fairness, mutual respect, accountability, and other ethical norms. So ethics promotes and develops guidelines for researchers, data sharing policies, copyright, and patenting policies. So research, ethical research, helps develop guidelines for sharing the data, for formulating policies regarding to copyright and patents. So all this is because of the nature of the research work that is carried on these days, which is collaborative in nature, where sharing of data becomes essential. So when you share the data, research data, with others, you need to be more trusty. You need to give more importance for trust, fairness, mutual respect, and accountability for the data that you share with your colleagues and or with other stakeholders. So here, ethical norms become more important. And when you share data with others, you need to develop policies we need to develop guidelines for formulating the policies, governing sharing of data, governing copyrights, use of copyrights and patents in research. So this is another important factor that enhances the importance of research, enhances the importance of ethics in research. Third is accountability to public. A research scholar is accountable to the public. He will be held responsible for the findings of his research and for the recommendations that he makes in his research if they are considered by the policymakers for at the time of policy framing. The ultimate beneficiary of the research is a society. So accountability to public is a basic thing in research. So when you are made accountable to public, so far as the findings and the recommendations that you have made in a research report makes you to follow ethical norms. If the norms followed are ethical, then even if the recommendations and findings are not popular, you can defend yourself. You can justify your research findings and suggestions. If the unethical practices are followed, then and if you are held accountable to your findings and research recommendations based on their findings, then you'll be exposed, and you are likely to be looked down upon by the fellow academicians because the recommendations you have made are based on unethical practices that you have followed in your research, and that makes you to feel sorry for that. So people who follow ethical norms will be bold, will be able to defend their findings and suggestions to the best of their ability, because they know that they have not followed any unethical norms while collecting the data, interpreting the data, and while preparing the while listing the findings and making the suggestions. So accountability to public makes people to follow ethical norms in research. If they are not hold accountable to public, then they are likely to be unethical in their research, or they may follow unethical practice in research. So ethics makes the people responsible while carrying out their research. The fourth point which highlights the importance of ethics in research is that it builds public support. Now, research gets public support when ethical values are followed in research. When integrity and quality of research is maintained, the government also encourages the research activities. So public support you will get if you follow ethical norms in carrying out research. People are likely to fund the research project if they trust the quality and integrity of the researcher. So if you follow ethical norms in carrying out your research or in publishing the findings of your research, and if you have followed ethical norms, you get applause from the public. Public will come forward to support you financially in your future research projects, as you have established your credentials as a good researcher by following ethical norms in research. So public support you will get if you follow ethical norms in research. Last point which highlights the importance of ethics in research is imparting social values. many of the ethical norms of research promote a variety of moral and social values, such as social responsibility, animal welfare, compliance with the law, and public health and safety norms. So, if one follows ethics in research, he will achieve social values also while carrying out his research. If no ethical practices are followed in research, then social values like human rights, animal welfare, compliance with law, and public health and safety are likely to be thrown to the winds. So these are the 5 points which highlight the importance of ethics in research. The next important item or point is principles of ethics in research. One is said to be ethical in research provided these principles are followed both letter and in spirit. First principle of ethics in research is informed consent. A research scholar, while collecting the data for research, should ensure that the respondents agree to take part in the research process by parting with the information that the research scholar requires from them. The consent should be obtained voluntarily and not by force. It is the duty of the researcher to obtain consent of the respondents before a questionnaire is served to him. He will come forward to share his views on the topic of research undertaken by the researcher, provided he agrees with the necessity and importance of the research on a particular issue. So, informed consent here refers to the willingness of the respondent to share the answers to the queries made by the research scholar. And this consent has to be taken without bringing any undue pressure on the respondent. So, informed consent, you should interact with the respondent, or you should get the questionnaire filled from the respondent, provided he agrees to part with the information or to fill the questionnaire. You cannot coerce him. You cannot subject him to duress. You cannot bring any undue pressure on him to fill the questionnaire. So that is the first principle of ethics in research. You should take the respondent into confidence and convince him of the need and the necessity of the information from him for conducting the research. And if he is convinced of the need and the necessity of research, that he will come forward to share his information, to share the information that he has, and cooperate with you in research, not otherwise. So informed consent is the first principle of ethics in research. Second important principle of ethics in research is confidentiality and privacy. Whatever information you get from the respondent should be held in close confidence. You should not share that with others. So that is very important principle of ethics in research. The researcher, the participant, should be assured that the information that he shares with the research scholar will be held in close confidence, and it will not be disclosed to anybody, and under any circumstances. Then only the respondents may agree to share his views with the research scholar and not otherwise. Now, participants' privacy is also an important ethics in research. You must ensure that the privacy of the respondent is always maintained while carrying on the research. So confidentiality and privacy is a second most important principle of ethics in research. Confidentiality means ensuring that information that we get from the respondents is held in close confidence. Means what? You should not go on record saying that these are the people who have said this on a particular topic of research. Confidentiality ensures that the source of information is not disclosed to anybody in the present, in the present as well as in the future. You should ensure that the information that you come across while carrying out research should be kept with you only. You should not share that with others. So that is the second principle of research, second principle of ethics in research. The third is principle of anonymity. Now, principle of anonymity means that the person will remain anonymous throughout the study, even to the researchers themselves. It's a stronger guarantee of privacy. So anonymity of the respondents in research should be maintained. Anonymity means what? You should not reveal his name and the organization where he is working and the position that he holds. You must ensure that his name is held in close confidence. Anonymity means what? You should not disclose the details of the respondent from whom you have collected the information. Anonymity of the information should be preserved, and no information used other than that for which permission was obtained should be made. So it is an investigator's responsibility to ensure that responsible authorities have confidence of the participant and that they bear some degree of responsibility in giving such permission. So anonymity principle or principle of anonymity simply means that the identity of the person from whom you have collected the data should not be revealed to anybody. The next principle of ethics in research is voluntary participation. For participation in research, people should not be coerced to participate in research. People should not be coerced. This is essentially relevant where researchers had previously relied on captive audiences for their subjects. So you cannot force a person to participate in research. You have to win their heart and confidence by convincing the need for data from them. And you should tell them that this data is going to be used for only academic purpose, and it is a society which will be benefited with the research. Then they may agree for participating in research. So what is required is voluntary participation and not making them to participate in research by coercing them or by threatening them or by bringing pressure on them. The participation of the participant in research should be on a voluntary basis. So that is the fourth principle of ethics in research. And the next one is right to service. Now, researchers have to deal with the ethical issues of persons' right to service. I mean, this happens in mostly in case of medical research. In medical research, we are told that there are two groups of people, two groups of respondents. One group is called as no treatment control group. No treatment control group, and another one is treatment control group. Now, no treatment control group are not administered the vaccine, whereas people in the treatment control group are administered the vaccine. Then after some time, the results of the people who are in the control group, a treatment control group, are compared to the results of people in the no treatment control group. And if the people in the treatment control group show some signs of recovery, the vaccine is said to be fit for human consumption. So this does not mean that the benefit of this vaccine should not be given to the people in the no treatment control group. People in the no treatment control group have a right to consuming the vaccine, which is administered to the people in the treatment control group. So this is called as right to service. Right to service. So two sets of people are there. One is no treatment control group. Another is treatment control group. Vaccine is administered to the people in the treatment control group, and a test is made. And if the tests are fruitful, if the tests are encouraging, then that will be manufactured on a large scale or on a commercial scale. So this doesn't mean that people who are in the no treatment control group will not get the benefit of that vaccine. They should also be given the benefit of that vaccine after the research is over. So this is called as right to service. So respondents have a right to service. This is an important principle of ethics in research so far as medical science is concerned. The next is respect for intellectual property. Researcher should honor patents, copyrights, other intellectual property rights. The mindset publish or perish may create problems if authorship is not given proper credit. Unpublished data should not be used without permission. And wherever credit is due, we have to give that. And proper acknowledgement or credit should be given for all people who contribute to research. So respect for intellectual property, we should invariably give. Then only will be said to follow ethical norms in research. We may borrow ideas or facts or figures from published data. We need to acknowledge them in the footnote of our research. Who should not indulge in what is called as plagiarism in research these days. So whatever facts you borrow from the published work, you should acknowledge that in your research. If you borrow figures from the work of others, that also you should acknowledge them. So as a researcher, you should respect the intellectual property. So this is one of the important principles of ethics in research these days. The last principle of ethics is a research scholar should be honest, objective. He should be integrity. He should have integrity, and he should respect for law. So researchers should strive for honesty in collecting data, in communicating data, and in analyzing the data. The data should not be falsified or fabricated or misrepresented. So you should be honest in research. You should be honest in collecting the data, communicating the data, and in analyzing the data. And the data should not be falsified or fabricated or misrepresented. So that is honesty. Second is there should be objectivity. Now, researchers should be objective in his research. So this means that he should not be biased. He should not be biased in data analysis and data interpretation. Personal or financial interest that would affect research should not be disclosed. So objectivity ensures that one is not biased in his research. You should not allow your whims and fancies to affect the research. You should be objective in your research. You should not be biased. Researchers should maintain integrity. It means researchers should keep promises. There should be consistency in thought and action. Researchers should be careful. Negligence and errors should be avoided. you should give respect to new findings and suggestions. So integrity, you should have integrity. And last is respect for law. Law of the land, who should respect? And law of the institution where we are working as academicians should also be respected while carrying on our research activity. And we should ensure that the output of research contributes to social welfare. We should also give respect to our colleagues. We should not discriminate amongst our colleagues on the basis of gender, race, and ethnicity. So these are the principles of ethics in research. It's when all these principles are followed in research, we say that we are ethical in research, not otherwise. My last slide gives a list of ethical misconduct that we come across in our academic life these days. And my sincere request to all the budding research scholars is to ensure that the ethical misconduct that is rampant these days is not followed by them in their research. Some of the important ethical misconduct that I have come across in my 34 years of service are as follows. First is publishing the same paper in different journals. So same article got published by the people in two different journals. This is an unethical practice. Including colleague as a co-author of a paper for a favor. So we write the research article on our own, but insert the name of our colleague only to get a favor from him. This is also very common these days. Third ethical misconduct in research is conducting a review of literature without acknowledging the contributions of other people. So when you undertake research, review of literature, it is necessary that you acknowledge the contributions of the people whose work you are reviewing. Fourth unethical practice is sabotaging someone's work. So this is called as plagiarism. You borrow heavily from the work of others and you give an impression that is your work. So this is an unethical practice. You borrow, there is nothing wrong in borrowing from others' work, but you should acknowledge that in your work. So then it will not amount to plagiarism. Otherwise, it amounts to plagiarism. And these days, universities are coming very heavily on the work that contains plagiarism to a very great extent. Next unethical practice is failing to keep research records. Now, a researcher collects research information for research from different sources. From the field work, he collects the field in question as from the respondents. From secondary sources, also he collects the records. He also interacts with the people in authority to know their views and opinions about a social phenomenon. So all such records you should keep with you even after the research work is over, so that if somebody questions the findings and suggestions made by you, you can throw the records that you are having on their face and ask them to see for themselves whether the findings and conclusions are right or wrong. So failing to keep research records is also an ethical misconduct. Next is overstating the sample size. This also is very rampant these days. Sample size is overstated. They collect the information from 100 people and say that they have collected the information from 1,000 people. This is unethical. It's an ethical misconduct. If you are a serious academician, such misconducts you should avoid. Then next is entertaining and bribing the supervisor. This also is rampant these days. The research scholars, to get the favors from the research guide or from other people, they entertain them, and they go to the extent of even bribing the supervisor. And I'm also told that ladies research scholars extend sexual favors to the people in power whose help they are badly in need of. So all such unethical practices we should avoid in our research. Next is fabricating the responses of the respondents. They say one thing and what you claim is another. So you are indulging in fabricating the responses of the students, which is highly unethical. So if you want to conduct the research ethically, you should not influence or fabricate the responses of the respondents. Whatever may be the findings of the research, we should record the responses of the respondents without influencing them or without falsifying them or without fabricating them. Then last but one misconduct according to me is keeping the respondents in dark about the purpose of research. This is also an unethical conduct in research. Whenever you meet the people with regard to getting the questionnaire filled from the respondents, you must frankly tell them why for you are collecting the data. And you should also ensure that you promise them to hold their name and responses in close confidence. So keeping the respondents in dark about the purpose of research is also an ethical misconduct. The last but not the least is manipulating the responses of respondents and secondary data. Some people manipulate the secondary data also to ensure that it serves their purpose. This also is ethical misconduct in research. So all these ethical misconducts that we come across these days needs to be avoided if the purpose of research is to be served. In conclusion, let me say that ethics in research is very important these days. If we are to hold our head high in academic circles, what is important is we follow ethical norms in research. The purpose of research is not solely to get the degree and to get monetary benefits after that. What is more important is the societal interests. We have to give, our research should help in formulating the policies that ameliorate the problems of the people at large. That should be at the back of our mind. And for that, we have to follow ethical norms in our research. Getting the degree is secondary, should be secondary and not primary. But whereas, unfortunately, it has become primary these days. And for that, they indulge in unethical practices, which will not go a long way in shaping their or in building their careers. So with these few words, I conclude my lecture. Hope you have enjoyed it.